And welcome back to Let's Play Star Trek Judgment Rites, Blind, Light and Darkness.
Captain's log. While exploring an uncharted star system in the Deneb sector, we received what we think is a message from a distress beacon on Onias 2. We're en route to investigate.
Okay. So what do we know about this stuff?
I advise referring to the star map and setting a course for the Onias system, Captain.
I thought it was Onias. Was it? Deneb? Nothing. How are they spelling Onias?
Onias 2, a Class M planet in a system Onias? Consisting of three unformed planets. Because of the high level of micrometeorite activity in the system, it is unusual for a Class M planet to exist. The planet is not inhabited and is not scheduled for colonization.
Okay. So, according to my little star map here, it is 11, which I believe is this. 1, 2, 3, 4 grids. Yeah. Should be here. Oh. Gonna save so I don't have to play.
Save new game.
Past the next episode again. Not completely sure what we're up to. 18, I think. So far, a much longer game than the original. Navigation here. Engage.
Approaching Onias 2, Captain.
It may be nothing, Captain, but a scan of the planet's atmosphere indicates a high concentration of rare gases trapped in the planet's magnetosphere. Atmospheric disturbances could produce random radio waves.
It wouldn't be the first time, Mr. Spock, but we'll never be able to tell if we don't check it out.
True.
After all, to seek out new life and new civilizations is our mission, to boldly go where no man has gone before.
A split infinitive, Captain.
What?
The proper grammatical expression is to go boldly where no man has gone before.
Somehow, I think it loses a little in the translation.
I know. That's practically heresy you've just committed, Spock.
We are too far from the planet for a detailed sensor probe, Captain.
Can we orbit?
Entering standard orbit.
Good. No battle? Okay, now, Mr. Spock. What do you have to say?
Fascinating, Captain. Sensors indicate only two faint life forms.
Oh.
It is difficult to distinguish, given the discharges in the planet's magnetosphere. It is, however, safe to transport to the planet's surface.
I don't suppose we can communicate with them at all? It looks like she's chewing gum or something.
No signal from the planet other than the distress beacon, sir.
Okay, well, let's beam down.
Captain, our sensors will not be particularly useful to you while you're down there. And communications may be erratic, sir.
We'll be fine, Lieutenant. What reason is there to worry?
I'm afraid, Captain, there are plenty of precedents. We'll be here if you need us.
I have no doubt of that.
I have tracked the signal to its source. It is near the life forms. The rest of the planet is quite desolate. No sign of life or technology. The atmosphere is thin, but breathable. And I detect numerous micrometeorite hits.
There are three unformed planets in the system. It's no wonder. There are so many micrometeorites. I'm surprised any Class M planet hasn't been pulverized by now.
It is not inconceivable, but it is certainly unusual.
Let's do it, Spock. You, McCoy, and I. Oh, and tell Bones to see if a genetic specialist's available. If there are only two life forms, we might be privileged to see life at its earliest stages.
Yeah, bring a red shirt specialist. Oh, we have... Oh, he's a blue shirt! We can't kill him?
Landed on a skeleton after the vultures have picked it clean.
A fascinating analogy, Doctor. Captain. The locus of the distress signal is in that building.
I think the doctor is right. Anything good here died a long time ago. It feels creepy to me.
Thank you for that opinion, Mr. Johns. I'll be certain to use creepy in my log entry about this.
He's an ensign, Johns. Alright, let's look at everything and each other.
James T. Kirk, as always, appears fit, alert, and ready for the challenges of the universe.
Hmm.
Spock frowns slightly as if distracted by your scrutiny.
Sorry, I didn't mean to look at you.
Ensign Johns looks around nervously and mutters under his breath. Dr. Leonard McCoy appears uneasy on this inhospitable world.
Hmm.
The building, which is old and pitted with micrometeorite strikes, appears ancient, and if built by humanoids, was created for tall individuals.
Yeah, really.
The doorway is unobstructed and appears normal except that it is taller and slightly more narrow than a terrestrial doorway.
Huh. It looks plenty wide from here.
This seems pointless.
Oh, yeah.
The dry, dusty red dirt cakes your boots in a thin patina that will be difficult to brush off.
Oops.
The dry, dusty red dirt. The bright yellow bowl of the sky is unremarkable, except in that you see absolutely no clouds or flying creatures at all.
Nor did we expect any. These little things, nothing?
Captain, may I suggest we continue with our mission? Captain, may I suggest we continue with our mission?
A magnificent desolation. Reminds me of a summer I spent on Mars climbing Olympus Mons.
You're kidding, right?
Nope.
It strikes me as unlikely, Captain, that this world is capable of sustaining the society and culture needed to generate the distress signals we have been receiving from here.
So somebody put them here.
Forgive me for saying so, sir, but this place is pitiful.
Huh. All the pits, I get it.
Well, I think I've finally found something I dislike more than having my molecules scrambled. This world.
Bones, stop complaining. There's nothing wrong with this place aside from a little dust.
Mm-hmm. Alright.
Save new game. Replace pre-
Save over. Let's see if I can go somewhere other than inside the building. I can, indeed. Oh.
An antenna. I wonder what it was meant for.
That's what we're here to find out, Mr. Johns.
Well, probably for receiving and or transmitting things. Let's see.
Stars twinkle just a bit through the thin atmosphere. Volcanic in origin, these rocks have been here for a long time. This seems pointless. Dr. Leonard McCoy rubs at his eyes as a little dust blows up.
There's dust in your eye.
Ensign Johns appears bored by the desolate surroundings.
First he was nervous and stuff, now he's bored.
James T. Kirk squints against the harsh sunlight on the surface of this world. Spock looks around, apparently at ease in these surroundings.
Hmm.
Volcanic in origin. The control mechanism for the array. Unlike the rocks surrounding it, the sensor array dish looks fairly new.
Not quite a picnic spot, but it has its charm. What do you think, Bones?
With the thin atmosphere, sunblock 187 would be nice.
Yeah.
You know, Jim, this is not the kind of place to inspire homesickness.
Aside from this sensor array, there is nothing unexpected here.
Correct.
I hope they didn't pay the landscapers very many credits for this work.
Okay. It makes sense out
Spock,
of here.
See what you can do with this.
Captain, until power has been returned to these controls, there is nothing I can do.
Yeah, we need power to them.
This appears in pretty good shape for having been out for so long. I wish I knew how to use it.
Oh, I forgot to analyze things.
The array appears to have deployed recently, which explains its lack of damage. The focal point of the dish is aligned approximately 35 degrees above the horizon.
Hmm.
This appears to be similar to Federation technology, Captain.
Lots to say.
Its control principles are similar to the Madai sensor dish on Vulcan. It has locked the array at a 35-degree angle. Without knowledge of the code control sequence, I cannot adjust it. I also detect that its power core is not functioning. It operates on geothermal energy, tapping into heat from the ground below.
So you're saying there's no heat in the ground below anymore?
Nothing unusual about that object, Captain. These rocks are approximately 1.3 billion years old and are volcanic in origin.
That's old.
Nothing unusual about that object, Captain.
So I think we came up from that way. Was there anything this way? Oh! Another sensor dish.
The clearing is filled with hard rocks, hot dust, and enough sharp edges to make everyone wary. Harsh winds and meteorite strikes have sorely weathered these ancient rocks. This seems pointless. James T. Kirk runs a strong hand over his smooth chin and studies his surroundings like a general surveying a battlefield.
Now, we had enough war last episode.
Dr. Leonard McCoy frowns as sweat forms on his upper lip.
Ew.
Spock ignores you as his restless gaze darts from feature to feature of the landscape.
How dare you ignore me, Mr. Spock?
Ensign Johns appears unenthused by the surroundings.
He's nervous and bored and unenthused.
Kinda reminds me of a Klingon penal colony, don't you think?
I think I would just as soon avoid the research needed to make that judgment, sir.
Yeah, I'm sure you would.
Someone once tried to talk me into buying a retirement villa on a world like this. It was a bargain.
Small wonder then.
This array is clear evidence of an ongoing alien interest in this world.
Someone selling ice water here would make a fortune.
In sharp contrast to the surrounding stones, the array glitters unblemished by the surroundings. The control mechanism for the array.
I suppose this one has power?
Interesting controls, right, Spock?
Fascinating.
I'm surprised at the high degree of engineering evidenced by this array.
Alright. Analyze.
Captain, the controls indicate the device is aligned at an angle approximately 35 degrees above the horizon. There appears to be some sort of anomaly in the control program that has misaligned the controls, but my tricorder is unable to determine it. Without a method of determining the proper angle, I'm afraid I cannot realign the dish. The array appears to have deployed recently, which explains its lack of damage. The support beneath the base is weak and crumbled. It is aligned to a point approximately 35 degrees above the horizon.
Okay, so just like the other dish then.
These controls do not seem to be functioning properly. The array is a precision instrument that shows a high degree of machining.
Just for fun.
A metal this durable should be used in reconstructive joint surgery. It's interesting that the control mechanism seems to have lasted as long as the actual array without taking damage.
I thought he was going to get pissed that we were asking him to look at it.
If I had built an array this solid, I would have scored much better on my SETI project and would have gotten more than old Tellarite sports broadcasts on it.
Yeah.
Testing. 1, 2, 3.
Maybe we'll let Spock work with the controls.
Alright, what's this way? Another one.
The arid terrain is composed of lava rocks, big and small. It would seem hospitable to a scorpion or a Klingon. The volcanic rocks bear tiny scars from siderite strikes, as very little burns up in the atmosphere here. This seems pointless. James T. Kirk seems not to notice as a little sweat trickles down the side of his face.
We're sweaties.
Dr. Leonard McCoy looks around as if desirous of a soft place to sit down. Spock's gaze darts quickly between features, doubtless cataloging them for a later report. Ensign John's irritated expression suggests frustration or a pebble in his boot.
Maybe both.
The sensor array's bright disc blossoms on a rock like a metal flower and points toward the distant horizon.
Pretty flower.
This small computer controls the elevation of the sensor dish.
The peacefulness of this planet is a nice change, isn't it, Mr. Spock?
Somewhat like the meditation grounds on Vulcan, Captain.
After our encounter with the Alassi, the Vardane, and their replica of the Enterprise, I can appreciate a few less stressful missions.
True, Captain.
True,
yeah. As long as you do not lower your guard, there is always the potential for danger.
Oh yes, especially in Star Trek.
The array appears to be in similar condition to the others we have seen. The array appears to be in similar condition
Wait.
To the others we have seen.
This is McCoy.
This is definitely the kind of place you want to be from, not heading to.
The difference between this place and hell is flames.
You overlook one other difference, Mr. Johns. As your author Mark Twain said, heaven for the climate, hell for the company.
Huh. Very good.
The array appears to have deployed recently, which explains its lack of damage.
Same.
This appears to be similar to Federation technology, Captain. Its control principles are similar to the Medai sensor dish on Vulcan. It has locked the array at a 35-degree angle. Without knowledge of the code control sequence, I cannot adjust it.
Mm-hmm. Similar to Federation technology.
Captain, until power has been returned to these controls, there is nothing I can do. The array dish is quite sturdy and doubtless still functional.
Why are you asking me? I think you need pointed ears to operate a device like this.
There's a response I was looking for.
Get Spock to look at it.
Get Spock to look at it.
This is probably in Mr. Spock's area of expertise, Captain. I don't see any adjustment mechanism on the array. It must be fixed to send and receive from a geosynchronous orbiting satellite.
Or to pick up and send signals to a ship that knows the location of these arrays.
Right.
We did not detect any satellite in orbit, Captain.
It could be cloaked, Kirk to Enterprise.
Yes, Captain.
Scan our area and see if you can locate any hidden or cloaked satellites.
It's being done now, sir. We find a neutrino beam being bent towards your position somewhere above you. But we can't find anything doing it. We'll keep looking.
If you find anything, let me know immediately. Kirk out.
Now, all that never would have happened if we hadn't instructed this guy to look at it?
Falling on this sort of rock could damage the skin rather badly.
No effect.
These rocks make me mindful of a long, tall, cool drink over ice. I don't understand any of this, Jim.
On this bit of rock, I get a 3.5 on the Mohs hardness scale. Fascinating.
Spock, why does everything you say always come out sounding like a personal log entry?
I do not see the logic in that action.
Okay, so what's down here? Nothing. We have to go back this way.
As Freud might say, sometimes a rock is just a rock. I don't understand any of this, Jim. I don't understand any of this, Jim.
He doesn't understand any of this, Jim.
I wonder if there is any fossilized life in this rock formation.
No effect. No effect.
curious to see what they say over here.
Surgical grade aluminum, not bad. I haven't a clue what to do with it, though. I could ask it to calculate pi to the last digit, but I don't think it would listen. Geology? I'm a doctor, not a rock hound.
Great.
I don't understand any of this, Jim.
This looks like one of those dishes I built in my SETI project classes at the Academy. The controls aren't familiar. This looks like the computer control for a SETI dish, except for some of those weird symbols. If we get stuck here, we could make millstones out of this rock.
Yeah.
No effect.
Alright, let's see. We know what's down that way. Let's see if we can go down this way. Okay, so there's these three screens, and then here. I have not analyzed anything here.
As improbable as it might seem, I'm getting multiple life form readings from inside this building.
Two?
This world is almost completely barren. The only life forms I can detect are nearby. The ozone layer is sufficient to allow the world to support life, but the lack of water vapor in the atmosphere makes survival marginal at best.
I see.
Captain, may I suggest we continue with our mission?
I'm a doctor, not a yard worker. That thing won't fall on us, will it, Jim? I'm a doctor, not a yard worker.
Okay.
Not meaning to be insolent, sir, but I'd need the strength of Samson or the wisdom of Solomon to be able to do that.
Not sure what I just asked him to do, demolish it?
This place makes more barren parts of Mars look pleasant by comparison. Not meaning to be insolent, sir.
All right. Let us...
Save new game. Replace pre...
Save. And go in. And first walk backward for a second. I remember this song.
Well, I have to hand it to whoever built this place. All this equipment looks brand new and in good repair.
Let's hope the Enterprise looks this good when it's this old.
We should be very careful about how we proceed, Captain. I have a strange feeling that evil is lurking nearby.
Evil, Ensign?
Something that wants to imperil our souls, sir. We must avoid that at all costs.
Huh. Evil, huh? Boss, I'm not sure how new some of this is. There's like moss or something going around this one. Or coming out of.
A large dry room. The huge ancient stones remind you of the buildings in Machu Picchu, Peru. Whoever built this, built it to last.
Machu Picchu, I like that.
Aside from minor differences in styling, this looks remarkably like a Tellarite 8000 DNA sequencer.
Yeah. What are you doing? Splicing DNA? Making clones?
If not for a thin covering of red dust, you would assume this DNA replicator had just been unboxed and set up.
What about this gunk?
This appears to be a patch of rust and dust that has accumulated on the machine's surface.
Green rust? Green dust?
Aside from minor differences in styling, if not for a thin covering...
Oh, that's the same, okay.
A door leading to another room.
No, that's actually a column.
A door leading to another room. A large dry room.
Okay.
Spock raises an eyebrow as he surveys the room. James T. Kirk, as always, appears fit, alert, and ready for the challenges of the universe.
You are not prepared for what awaits you, Q says.
Dr. Leonard McCoy smiles as he is confronted with a familiar environment. Ensign Johns wears his surprise at the surroundings transparently on his face.
Not bored anymore, huh?
interesting equipment we have here.
A DNA synthesizer and replicator. This is one of the most advanced genetic facilities I have ever seen. How unusual.
How so, Spock?
Even visitors to this planet would leave behind a substantial number of artifacts. Sending only a genetics lab does not fit established archaeological patterns.
That's interesting. This place is so advanced, it looks rather simple, really. Two sequencers and two, I guess, computers to work them?
I haven't seen equipment like this since I interned on Talara. Such equipment. In such a place.
Interesting equipment we have here.
Oh, yeah, he already said that.
You know, a person could do serious research with a device like this. What an odd piece of equipment to find in a place like this.
True that. Yeah. Analyze.
There are life form readings just to the east and west of this room.
Oh, I see. There's got another doorway here. I didn't even realize that.
Aside from some dust and dirt and a small chemical deposit on the intake nozzle, this DNA replicator appears to be in the same condition that it was 50,000 years ago.
And this one we don't... wait.
This DNA sequencer appears to be nearly 50,000 years old. Yet it has not broken down and appears to be fully powered.
Indeed. Let's just see what everybody has to say then.
Wow, this is almost identical to an 8000 sequencer. Cutting edge Federation technology. Just input a sample, and the sequencer analyzes it so it can be spliced or altered on the genetic level with the replicator. Wow, this is almost identical to... Captain, we have to run a set of source samples through the sequencer before I can make a composite sample with the replicator.
Okay.
Captain, we...
This looks like a Tellarite 8000. Do you think Tellarites were here and have duplicated the design?
Unlikely, Doctor. But that is an interesting observation.
It's fairly simple to operate. You input samples into the sequencer and you can combine with the replicator. Using the replicator is the hard part of the operation.
I see.
I don't understand any of this, Jim.
Does Jim understand any of this?
No, I don't think that's necessary.
Not necessary to understand this?
No, I don't think that's necessary.
Can we work the controls here?
Captain, Ensign Johns would be the ideal person to operate this device. It appears to be ancient, yet resembles devices that were introduced into the Federation last year. Captain,
Oh, he's just analyzing.
There are life form readings. Captain, Ensign Johns...
All right, Ensign Johns. Didn't I order him to do something?
Wow, this is almost like... Captain, we have to run...
Alright, we need to do stuff. Let's head... this way. East. Hello?
Greetings, gentle beings, and welcome. I am Azra of the Omegan people.
Hi.
You are the salvation we have long sought. Thank you for answering our summons.
An angel!
Actually... It is the projected image of an angel, Mr. Johns.
Jim, somewhere in that machine behind the portal are single-cell organisms. They have a healthy metabolism and a long lifespan, but an extremely low rate of reproduction.
Can you tell that from all the way over there?